Looking back, looking forward, looking down, looking up, looking around. Journey of exploration to the distant past, to the frontiers of tomorrow, from the infinitely small to the infinitely large, the mysterious, the mundane. Come, let us travel to the horizons of knowledge. This program has been made possible thanks to a generous grant from the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation, the Vodafone Egypt Foundation, the OPEC Fund for International Development, and the Carnegie Corporation of New York.
The enormous diversity of life, a constant and endless source of fascination for humans from the most ancient of times. We have successfully categorized all living creatures. We have successfully linked them into families and placed the families in kingdoms and many steps in between. Yet, how do we organize the enormous amount of information that has been written about each of the many organisms that we know of? How do we find our way around all this information? No single book is big enough. Or is it? With the help of the internet, scientists in the early part of the 21st century are collectively writing such a book. It will include all the species known and all the literature on the biodiversity on this planet. It is right to call it the Encyclopedia of Life. The story of classifying life. In the 18th century, Swedish botanist, physician, and zoologist Carl von Linné, known by Linnaeus, devised a new system to classify and identify all the creatures, large and small, that so many scientists had been studying. By classifying them on the basis of observed characteristics, and then grouping them into families and subfamilies and individual species, each denominated by two names. The idea of a genus and a species was born. Thus, we are Homo sapiens. Our genus is the hominids, Homo, and our species is sapiens. Species could not interbreed, or if they do, they produce sterile offspring, as in a horse and a donkey producing a mule. But within species, almost infinite varieties can exist. Look at over 100,000 varieties of rice, all wild relatives of the Oryza sativa, a wild grass domesticated millennia ago. Today, the Linnaean system has evolved into the universal system for classifying organisms in biology. The contributions of many others brought the system into sharper focus and allowed for much more detail. Today, we consider all living things part of one out of possible several kingdoms. Earlier classifications used to refer to 5 or 6 kingdoms or domains of life, and now we use 8. Animalia, Archaea, Bacteria, Chromista, Fungi, Plantae, Protozoa, and viruses. Each kingdom has subdivisions. In fact, it's a whole cascade of levels that allows us to classify things with great precision. Domains to kingdoms, to phylum, to class, to order, to family, to genus, to species. Now, we usually refer to each species by the genus and the species names only, and that usually is enough to position it. Now, this cascade of levels allows us to exquisitely place every creature in relation to each other. A lot of questions about the exact relationships between different organisms persist, and new organisms are being identified each day. But the general number of higher groupings remains approximately stable. Today, we have additional evidence that identifies species and their relations to each other. The analysis of DNA has become an invaluable tool in this type of analysis. It has confirmed much of the structure of the Linnaean classification. Let's take an example to see how this works. Let's take the grizzly bear. Let us start with the animal kingdom. It includes all sorts of creatures. How do we find the grizzly bear? Let us take the phylum Chordata. We therefore eliminate all those animals that do not have a spinal cord, like the sea star. And even more specifically, we look at the subphylum Vertebrata Craniata, which are animals with backbones. There are over 57,674 species there, and therefore we can eliminate the sharks and the rays. We can eliminate the octopus. Then we look at the class Mammalia, the mammals. Those are creatures who lactate, who have hair, and who have a special structure of the ear. And so we can eliminate the fish. And we can eliminate the birds. And we can eliminate the reptiles. Now, within the mammals, we look at the order Carnivora, the carnivores, the meat eaters. And thus, we can eliminate the squirrel, and we can eliminate the cow. And within the carnivores, we want to look at the family Orsedia, the bears. So we can eliminate the fox, and we can eliminate the lion. Now within the bear family, we have one really strange creature, well known and well loved, the giant panda. The giant panda is really Ailuropoda melanoica, literally meaning cat foot black and white. It is a bear native to central, western, and southwestern China. It is easily recognized by its large, distinctive black patches around the eyes, over the ears, and across its round body. And though it belongs in its classification to the order Carnivora, the meat eaters, the giant panda's diet is 99% bamboo. Other parts of its diet include honey, eggs, fish, yams, shrubs, leaves, oranges, bananas, whenever they're available. But it is still counted as a bear among the carnivores. However, for our purposes, we bid it farewell. Now we focus on the true bears, the genus Ursus. And within that, we can define the genus and the species, and we look at the Ursus arctos, the brown bear. And the grizzly bear is a subspecies of the brown bear. It is known as Ursus arctos, sometimes called the silver-tipped bear, but it is a subspecies of the brown bear, and it generally lives in the uplands of Western North America. So now we can see that every species and even subspecies is precisely determined and named, and that much scientific literature exists about each species. And remember that the same taxonomic system applies to defining microbes, bacteria, viruses, as well as sponges and mushrooms in all the kingdoms of life. So how many species do we have precisely identified around the world? Right now, we estimate about 1.8 to 1.9 million species have been scientifically identified. And there's a mountain of scientific literature that describes all this biodiversity. Around 300 to 600 million pages of material. So how do we go about creating an encyclopedia of life? It requires an enormous collaboration among a lot of scientists around the world and the establishment of links between existing databases and a huge collaboration between all the libraries that hold all this published material about biodiversity.
One of our priorities has been to share knowledge about life on Earth with as many people as we can. We've launched an initiative called the Encyclopedia of Life.
The goal of the Encyclopedia of Life is to make a web page, an infinitely expandable web page for each of the 1.9 million known species on Earth.
The Encyclopedia of Life is one giant collaboration with contributions not only by science, but by the general public.
المشروع فكرته بسيطة جدا هو عبارة عن ويب سايت بيضم صفحة لكل نوع من أنواع الكائنات بيشرح بيعطي صورة للكائن وشرح عن خصائص الكائن ده وموطنه تصنيفه واسمه اللاتيني بالإضافة إلى لينكس للمراجع العلمية الموجودة عن الكائن ده على الإنترنت.
This has now been done. And it starts with a fairly simple structure. Like most things on the internet, we start with a website. From there, we can access the species pages, the 1.8 or 1.9 million species pages, one page for each species. Behind the species pages is the massive biodiversity heritage library with its 300 to 600 million pages of text. So how do we retrieve information out of this enormous reservoir of knowledge? Let's see how this works for the example of the grizzly bear. So first we go to the website. And we have a choice among the eight kingdoms: Animalia, Archaea, Bacteria, Chromista, Fungi, Plantae, Protozoa, and Viruses. And we go to Animalia. And within the Animalia, we pick chordates. Then we select for mammals. And within mammals, for carnivores. And then within the carnivores, for Ursidiae. And then for Ursus arctos. And finally, we settle for Ursus arctos horribilis, and we are back with the grizzly bears. Behind the species page from the Biodiversity Heritage Library, we have thousands upon thousands of pages about grizzly bears. But what about us in the Arab world? Well, we have also organized the Arab scientists to participate in this enormous enterprise. So we set about organizing the Arab world. And I was privileged to invite 300 of the leading Arab scientists working on biodiversity to come to the Library of Alexandria and to discuss how we are going to organize ourselves for this task. We also invited scientists in linguistics involved in translation, machine translation, and other systems to discuss with the biologists what we could do about the enormous material of the EOL. Now, this will not only ensure that Arab scientific input is available in the EOL, it will also allow for translation of key parts of this encyclopedia of life into Arabic. It will also allow Arab scientists to collaborate with each other across the whole Arab world in this important field.
من 2008 إلى 2009 استطاع إنه يحط أو الجماعة اللي بيشتغلوا على هذا الموقع استطاعوا إنهم يحطوا أكثر من 170 ألف صفحة من الصفحات على هذا الموقع. كل صفحة زي ما قلت بتحتوي عن المعلومات اللي معروفة عن نوع معين من أنواع الحياة.
هي مثلا مصر فيها أنواع من النباتات والحيوانات مش موجودة في أي منطقة تانية في العالم غير في مصر. فالأنواع دي بنسميها أنواع إنديميك أو أنواع متوطنة. وفي 52 نبات مش موجود غير في مصر. في بعض الحيوانات والطيور مش موجودة غير في مصر. بنحاول نجمع معلومات عن كل واحدة من هذه الأنواع وتوصيف لها وتوزيعها في مصر، وهكذا نعمله في كل المنطقة اللي حوالينا، ونعمله كمان باللغة العربية.
But beyond the collaborations between scientists, we are turning to the public. We learned from Wikipedia, the great encyclopedia created by more than 100,000 persons who do not know each other, who collaborate under the orchestration of Jimmy Wales. So in all we are doing, we are now calling on a lot of people to help. The material that the public can post is identified by a yellow tag. The yellow tag is removed only after it has been reviewed by specialists to make sure that the information is correct. So now we really have started to create the Encyclopedia of Life. It is already an enormous undertaking and is picking up speed in implementation as more and more institutions gather together to make this dream a reality. It will keep growing as we try to catch up with all the knowledge that is out there, and as knowledge keeps increasing every day. Millions and millions of pages are being posted and will continue being posted forever.
Right, included on the Encyclopedia of Life are things like pictures, maps of where organisms are found, information about how they relate to other kinds of organisms.
So over the next few years, we are embarking on several major themes. The first one is a marine theme. So we're trying to gather together 90 to 95% of marine species and make sure that there's information on those. Beyond that, we'll probably tackle other similar themes with the goal, after 10 years, of having all species covered in some way on the encyclopedia. But the encyclopedia will never be finished. Right now, we're collecting that information in as many different languages as we can, but we need to make sure that it's available in all languages and that it's constantly changing as new knowledge about species is being obtained.
Almost 2 million species pages, over 600 million pages of scientific literature. What an incredibly rich source of information about life on Earth. And just imagine how much richer it could be if we could read every one of those millions of pages in our own language. That is beyond the reach of human translators, but perhaps not beyond the reach of machines. If we can solve the problems of machine language translation and natural language processing, computers could offer us a direct means of translation so that we can read those millions of pages in our own language. Is that another dream? Yes, but that dream too has a group of pioneering people working on it, and they are making lots of progress and it's becoming a reality. How they approach the problem and what they're doing and the vistas they are opening up every day are a very exciting story. But that is a story for another day. I am Ismail Serageldin, and I thank you for having joined me in this episode of Horizons.